The world is in danger. Scientists are now warning that the danger is from man himself. The danger was spelt out at a worldwide conference this summer. Humanity is conducting an experiment whose ultimate consequences could be second only to a global nuclear war. A morning rush hour, like any other. But some morning, in the not-too-distant future, this could be the news.
Capital reports.
At 8 o'clock, I'm Brian Milligan. The government's unveiled dramatic new plans to fight pollution and save energy. They're an attempt to stop the greenhouse effect, which is heating up the earth. The government's plans are aimed at car drivers and homeowners alike. In an effort to reduce carbon dioxide emissions that are polluting the atmosphere, the national speed limit is to be cut to just 50 miles an hour. Not only that, but tax allowances on company cars are to be abandoned, and less fuel-efficient cars will cost more. Also, there'll be an attempt to cut down traffic in the inner cities by half. From now on, cars with number plates beginning with an even number will be allowed in only on even dates, and those beginning with an odd number on odd dates only. And perhaps most dramatic of all, you'll have to declare how energy efficient your house is before you sell it. The more efficient the house is, the more you'll be able to sell it for.
Easy to switch off a fictitious broadcast. Not so easy to banish the possibility that it might one day be real. And that possibility has increased, it seems, partly as a result of the Prime Minister's summertime reading, which included an alarming US congressional report on the heating up of the world's climate. That report was among several influences which led Mrs. Thatcher, previously not renowned for environmental concern, to make her recent speech to the Royal Society on the need to protect the balance of nature. And that speech has dramatically forced political attention on what science has long referred to as the greenhouse effect. The sun's rays reach us through the Earth's atmosphere. The Earth gives off infrared radiation, some of which is trapped on its way into space by what are called the greenhouse gases, allowing the Earth to retain the heat it needs. But the steady increase in these gases means that more and more heat is being trapped. Many scientists believe that the world is becoming dangerously warmer. The gases include methane, rotting rubbish is a major source, CFCs from products like aerosols, which also damage the ozone layer, and carbon dioxide, or CO2, by far the biggest ingredient, produced by burning fossil fuels, coal, oil, gas.
That we will bring about so large an increase in average temperatures that we begin to melt the polar ice caps and sea levels rise. And people are predicting already very considerable increases in sea level by around 2025 of the next century. The next major impact will be in climatic shifts affecting agricultural production, so that some of the most productive areas in the world today will cease to be productive grain growing or other food producing areas, and some will be marginally better off. But because their topsoils aren't suitable for agricultural production, it means a net loss to world agricultural production. And the third main area is the way in which the greenhouse effect will exacerbate major climatic perturbations, whether it's droughts, whether it's floods, whether it's hurricanes, whatever it might be, the greenhouse effect will make all of those much worse. And so within a relatively short period of time, you're talking about a devastating impact upon world climate patterns.
Some scientists point to recent global temperature figures as evidence that the greenhouse effect has accelerated. The five hottest years in the last century have all been in the 1980s. 80, 81, 83, 87, and 88.
We've already seen a 0.5 degree centigrade change in average world temperatures in about 60 years. Now that may not sound much, but the total difference between the darkest, coldest moment of the last ice age and where we are now was a mere 4 degrees centigrade. So that gives you a measure of the scale of change that we're now talking about in a very, very short period of time.
No longer are such concerns the prerogative of environmentalists. Last month, the Prime Minister, to widespread surprise, drew attention to the buildup of carbon dioxide. Half of the amount emitted since the Industrial Revolution remains in the atmosphere. Aldborough, on the coast of Suffolk. While some parts of Britain can expect that the greenhouse effect will bring the blessings of a Mediterranean climate, here there is fear that their most formidable enemy could become more hostile still. That hostility is relentless and costly. At present, Aldborough is faced with replacing three blocks in its sea defence wall, damaged in one night of violent storm, at a cost of £100,000. But the whole structure needs rebuilding, at a cost of £5 million. And even then, in the course of the next 50 years, the greenhouse effect could overwhelm it. The threat to Aldborough is part of the age-old threat that the coast of East Anglia knows only too well. But what much of today's scientific evidence is telling us is that that threat will grow more widespread and more intense over the next 50 years. To ignore the danger is to invite the consequences. What the poet Louis MacNeice wrote just before World War II could become a prophecy for our own times. The glass is falling hour by hour. The glass will fall forever. But if you break the bloody glass, you won't hold up the weather. What the weather threatens with sea levels rising as part of the greenhouse effect has been the subject of a recent scientific study. The study's forecast for Britain 50 to 100 years from now points to several areas of high risk. In the north of England, along the Tees estuary, extensive flooding of reclaimed land. Along the south coast, from Brighton to Bournemouth, erosion and flooding. On the east coast, sea defences will be broken down around the Wash, the Fens and the Norfolk Broads. And in the Thames estuary, widespread floods bringing major damage to industrial and residential development. Overall, what the study warns of is a change in the shape of Britain's coastline over the next 100 years, unless we start now to plan to meet the danger. The rapid development of the London Docklands and of other desirable waterside districts in many American cities is a matter of growing concern for scientists who have been calculating the expected rise in sea levels as the world heats up. Dr. Bill Carter of the University of Ulster is one of the country's leading experts in this field and author of the recent study of Britain's long-term prospects. He predicts an average sea level rise of 1 to 2 meters in the next century around the country, but a possible 6 meters for some parts of the southeast.
I'm surprised that this type of development can go ahead without any recognition at all of the sea level rise problem.
What could this area look like 100 years from now? What could it be like to live here?
I think people will still live here, but I think those people will have to take account of rising sea level. They'll have to get used to disruption in their lives. They'll have to get used to occasional threats from flooding, disruption of the phone service, the electricity, the sewage, and so forth. It's going to be an area which is somewhat at risk, and I certainly wouldn't be one taking out a 99-year lease in this area.
Of course, in this particular case, there is the London Barrier. Surely that's going to be a defence.
Oh, yes, the London Barrier would certainly protect this area in the short term against tides and floods. But the sea level rise that we're talking about is likely to rise above the barrier to some extent in the middle of the next century.
And beyond the barrier, the risk for the unprotected Thames estuary will be greater still. At present, the weather is costing Britain £1 billion a year in insurance claims. Dr. Carter believes that for the future, we need a strategy by which some areas are protected at high cost, while in others, nature is allowed to take its course.
Well, I think the decision will have to be made whether we need to protect these areas or whether we need to abandon these areas. Certainly some parts of the coastline will simply be abandoned in the face of this threat.
If we were to embark on the kind of program that you've outlined for the country, what would it cost and could we afford it?
We could afford it if we started to allocate resources for it at this stage, but if we are faced with paying for a major disaster at some point in the future, we would virtually have to mortgage the country, I suspect, to pay for it. It would be a devastating effect on the economy.
For many, the risk is not too much water, but too little. In a world where millions already live and die on the margin of existence, third world crop failures, even more frequent than today, together with a reduction in what the American breadbasket could deliver, could add up to global disaster. The third risk is from sudden, severe disturbances.
There has always been the greenhouse effect. What has happened since the Industrial Revolution is that it has intensified because of the burning of fossil fuels. And we can expect that there will be an increase in incidence of these extreme events as we go into the next century.
What the world is being forced to recognize is that curbing the greenhouse effect will require us to rethink how we generate energy and how we use it. For many of us, the rethink must begin at home.
Just tried to go out and buy some appliances for a new kitchen. I was astonished by the fact that neither on the appliance nor in the shop could anybody easily tell me how much energy these appliances were using, whether some were more efficient than others. Now, that kind of consciousness has got to be introduced or reintroduced if we're going to really get anywhere with this energy conservation and efficiency campaign.
In the home, the least efficient washing machine uses £45 worth of electricity a year. The most efficient, only £25 worth. As for fridges, the least efficient costs £24 a year to run, the most efficient, just £9. The home itself is often an inefficient consumer. But no overall strategy for carbon dioxide reduction could ignore transport, which accounts for one-fifth of emissions into the atmosphere. For the individual motorist, such a strategy could be much more restrictive than the campaign for unleaded petrol. It could mean different rates for vehicle licenses according to fuel efficiency. It could mean a reduction of company cars, and more widespread measures too.
Quite clearly, the kind of measures that we would need to take to get emissions down would be perhaps the instigation of lower speed limits, say 50 miles per hour on motorways, as happens in North America. It might also be necessary to restrict cars from the centre of major conurbations to prevent the kind of stop-start driving which is so energy inefficient. Other schemes which might discourage people for driving fast and driving a lot might be, for instance, the greater use of toll roads, to discourage people from driving longer distances.
How significant an achievement would it be if we did manage to cut CO2 emissions by 20%? How far along the road of what's necessary would that take us?
I think it would actually be a colossal achievement if we pulled off a 20% reduction in carbon dioxide emissions, because the scale of the measures that are needed are simply vast.
The Prime Minister herself has expressed anxiety about the greenhouse effect. To that considerable extent, it is on the political agenda. But the implications for policy making are wide and complex. There must be questions about the future of coal-fired power stations, and this at a time when the government is planning to privatize coal as well as electricity. Those questions affect the future of nuclear power, despite other concerns about it. Alternative sources of energy, wind and wave power, need to be considered. And in the end, it's impossible to foresee an effective strategy which doesn't involve a significant degree of coercion.
This is a particularly difficult problem for governments like our own to act upon, because it requires very definite government intervention in free market mechanisms. It requires governments to tell people what to do, to charge people higher prices through taxes, all the kinds of things Mrs. Thatcher's government does not like to do.
The Department of the Environment now finds itself in the front line following Mrs. Thatcher's recent speech. The Prime Minister has put the greenhouse effect and the need to respond to it in a position of considerable prominence in the political agenda. Is that where it's going to stay?
Oh, yes, firmly, because it is the biggest single threat to sustainable development.
But if we are to change our ways in manners that may well be required in order to not be in jeopardy, doesn't human history and human nature suggest that there's going to have to be some element of compulsion and regulation as to the way we live?
There's also the voluntary approach. Naturally, one's got to back it up with regulation and compulsion if that is necessary. But what we need to know is an awful lot more than we know at present.
Well, in terms of curbing CO2 emissions, can we continue to build coal-fired power stations?
Well, this is an area that we're all looking into. The Department of Energy have got a world-leading programme in finding alternatives to fossil fuel. First of all, we must price fossil fuel at its true economic cost. We can't go on subsidising it. That's one of the things we're pushing for in the world. We must also utilise what we do use most efficiently.
Is this an argument for more and more nuclear power, which of course, as we know, carries other kinds of risk?
It is one of the results of the Toronto conference that it was suggested that some people re-looked at nuclear power as an option, because if some people are moving out of nuclear power without giving due thought to alternatives, they could well be adding to the greenhouse effect.
For many people in Britain, the greenhouse effect and the prospect of a warmer Mediterranean climate may indeed seem attractive. But the threat to our coastline from the rising sea levels we can expect over the next 50 years is real and highly dangerous for industry, for agriculture, for the very survival of some key parts of this country.
We're very lucky in this country. We have centrally funded by the government one of the four climate modelling stations in the world. There's one in Germany and there's two in America. Now we're going to need a lot more information from them over the next 5 years. It's going to take about that time to get the global effects of what is going to happen. It's going to be another 20 to 30 years before we can tell what's going to happen on a regional basis. Now before that happens, we've also got to take, as I said, the precautionary approach.
But that precautionary approach seems to amount in effect to commissioning further detailed research. In the Netherlands, the need for action is regarded much more urgently. For centuries, survival behind the dikes and dunes has demanded that. And now this village, 30 miles from Amsterdam, faces a new emergency.
This village is very vulnerable, but it's not just this village. If this narrow stretch of dunes will break, which is possible with a rising sea level, then the whole part of the Netherlands will flood up to Amsterdam. We are planning, and on the basis of a sea level rise of a double or triple as it is now. And in this planning, it's very important already to consider who is going to pay for the extra protective measures.
The Dutch government is considering a heavier local tax for protection as a disincentive to live in vulnerable areas. But many more areas could become vulnerable.
But with an ever-increasing greenhouse effect, an ever-increasing sea level, which may happen if emissions increase of CO2 and other greenhouse gases, we might, in the end, virtually have to move to Germany.
Whatever strategy the Dutch devise for defense against rising sea levels, the fundamental problem, which is increasing that risk, but which no country can cope with on its own, is the greenhouse effect itself. The Dutch government is not optimistic about the international community's response.
With regret, I have to say no. With a lot of problems, when you can show people what's going on, for example, sea level rising, then I can show with the map of the Netherlands what's going on and that I have to spend money. But with this problem, people are saying, look at the sky, what can I see? It's blue again or it's raining again. So we need to explain in a very clear way what's going on. And that within really a short period, even in our lifetime, not only the children of us, they will be confronted with this problem.
What we do know is that there's enough scientific opinion available now to require us to take action. And for too long, I think, we've waited, particularly industrial nations, where there's a competition, if you like, between ecological effect and industrial concern. Short-term industrial concerns have predominated. And we've waited for scientific opinion to prove things beyond reasonable doubt. Well, the day for that, in dealing with the greenhouse effect, is surely overdue. It's gone, it's finished.